Hello, foodie friends. So we're in the third of our corny souvenir road trip cookbooks tour. And this one's a little bit on the special side. So we're gonna be doing Ma's Cooking Mountaineer Recipes. This one in particular is from 1969. And I actually noticed that my grandmother picked this up in the Great Smoky Mountains in Gatlinburg, Tennessee. However, this particular cookbook is actually geared more towards the Ozark Mountains and that region. And towards the end, we'll look at some different things about this that kind of makes this cookbook a little, should we say, weird? And so I kind of had a hard time picking anything out of this cookbook that would be interesting to make or different or even good. I'll just be honest with you. We don't eat raccoon and we don't eat possum. And well, there's just a bunch of stuff in here that we wouldn't eat. So I finally settled on a dessert just because I figured with enough sugar and enough fat, it's usually really hard to have a bad recipe come from that. So that's what we're gonna do. We'll go ahead and throw this together, have a taste, see if it holds up, and then kind of talk about the rest of what might be a little bit of a train wreck. So let's go ahead and get started.
Pause here to write down what you'll need to follow along. First, in a large bowl, we're going to go ahead and mix together our dry ingredients. So that would be your flour, baking powder, salt, and your sugar. Once it's mixed, go ahead and set that aside. Now you're gonna take an apple, peel it, and dice it into little pieces. Every time I start to peel an apple, I think about that Andy Griffith episode, Man in a Hurry, where Andy tries to get a city man to slow down and enjoy country living. He asks him if he's ever tried to peel an apple without breaking the apple peel. And of course, the city man thinks that's ridiculous. In the end, the city man slows down and tries to peel an apple himself. As you can see, I actually broke my apple peel, so maybe I need a lesson in slowing down. Now in another bowl, you're going to lightly beat one egg, add your melted butter or margarine, and then toss in your apples. I ended up only needing about one apple, and then go ahead and stir that to coat and set that aside. Now you're gonna add those ingredients to your dry ingredients. Mix together, and now you're going to kinda guesstimate how much milk you need. I ended up only needing a half a cup to actually make a good dough, so start with that first. Now the key to good frying is to have everything ready before you even heat up your oil. Make sure you have some paper towels on a good plate with some tongs, that way you can drain the grease. I went ahead and mixed up some cinnamon and sugar to roll them in, but I also got some powdered sugar ready just as the recipe says. Now always go ahead and fry a little piece of dough first to make sure your oil is hot enough. This is perfect, as you can see this little piece is golden brown. Now go ahead and drop in the dough by the spoonful. Just make sure that none of them are touching each other, otherwise you'll have one big clump of dough. Fry each one to a real beautiful golden brown. I ended up needing to turn mine about halfway through just to make sure I got both sides evenly, and then place on your towel to let them drain. Now here's the fun part. We get to play with sugar. Go ahead and roll them into your mixture, or if you'd rather just stick with the powdered sugar, just go ahead and sprinkle some on top. And now you're ready for some good eating.
All right, so we're just gonna dig in because you know what fried food means on this channel. You gotta eat it quick while it's hot. Okay, let's try this one. Let's try a half, yeah. Because I made two different kinds, so we'll try this one first. Mmm. I mean, It's what I thought. Fried fat and sugar.
You can't really mess that
up. You really can't. And this is the one I did with the cinnamon and sugar mixture. Now, the recipe book actually recommended the powdered sugar, so you want to try that one next, and we'll just see what it tastes like exactly as the recipe said. Okay.
I mean, it's good.
I think, personally, I like the cinnamon sugar better.
Yeah, I think so.
But I've always been more of an elephant ear person than a funnel cake person. And if you've ever had an elephant ear, you're going to know exactly what I'm talking about. But both versions are good.
Yeah. I mean, they're very reminiscent of things I've had at fairs.
Yeah.
You know, you can get apple fritters at fairs very similar.
Yeah, I would typify this as a fair food. I think that's fair. Anyway.
It's a fairly fair food.
Oh, okay, no. That was way... that was too far. But anyway. So I'm actually going to go... Now, personally, I think I would give this recipe a 4. Just because I lean, like I said, I lean more towards your crispier kind of elephant ears. Like your more flat pieces of dough than I do like your more puffed up dough, mean, like a funnel cake.
Honestly,
but the addition of the apples was good in it. I like that.
Yeah, it's not, like I said, I'm pretty sure it's something I've had before.
Oh, definitely. It's been like a fried apple pie or something.
It'd be nice to have a little extra something else.
Yeah, you know, maybe some drizzle icing or something on it.
Cinnamon with the dough or something that...
No, that's true. You know what I mean? I would actually add more apples.
Yeah.
Too.
Like or nutmeg or something. You know what I mean? Like something in there with it to give it a little extra body.
Something even if you don't get the sugar. Just fat and sugar.
And yeah, I mean, you got the apples, you know, obviously. I mean, it's good. Don't get me wrong.
Right. Like,
I'll eat the rest of these. You ain't gonna have to tell me to eat the rest of it.
They're gonna be gone.
You're not gonna have to remind me that it's there. But at the same time, like, I don't know, I guess with all the other stuff we've done.
That's true. Nothing, I think with the other desserts that were more interesting.
Yeah, there's nothing about this that kind of sets it apart or says, like, this is something special that I really wanna do again.
I'm so glad you brought that up.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, and I'm really glad you brought that up because to me, that typifies this entire cookbook.
Oh.
Like, it's not something I'd write home about. That's basically, whenever, like, while I was looking through this cookbook, you know, and it kind of confused me. I mentioned before that my grandmother picked this up in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, which is a huge, oh my gosh, one of the biggest tourist attractions we have here in East Tennessee.
Oh,
I mean,
it's
the foothills of the Smokies.
I mean, the Smoky Mountains is, I mean, I'd say most people in America have heard of it.
Oh yeah, if you've ever heard of Dollywood or wanted to go to Dollywood, you've heard of this region.
Yeah.
So, and that's what really confused me because as I started looking through this cookbook, I realized that this is actually made in the Midwest, Missouri, and all the recipes were submitted by people from Missouri.
Hmm.
But you have a very caricatured rendition of Southern hillbilly culture that people make fun of. You know, you've got your drunk, you know, Mountain Dew guy leaning against a tree.
Yeah, he's got his moonshine bottle.
Yeah, there's his sitting by the outhouse, you know, while the woman does all the work, you know. I mean, that's probably not changed in decades, but...
Thanks.
But, you do help out. But...
But see, she's not even in a kitchen. She's cooking outside.
Yeah, she's cooking outside. She's fixing to boil a chicken. But, you know, this... And when I was looking at the inside of it, The recipes to me were reminiscent of what I would find like in a caricatured Southern cookbook.
Right.
And some of the stuff that's written in here is very like, okay, it's what Northerners that have never been to the South think that all Southern people sound like and that we can't spell. Like we don't, like we're the most uneducated group. But anyway, I mean, and we don't want to like get into a big, like, you know, kick a dead horse with this thing, but Okay, maybe I should just give you a sample. And I'm going to try. Now, bear in mind, I have a huge southern family, okay? Way bigger than the northern side of my family. And it was always a huge thing to me if, you know, I went up north on vacation or whatever after I moved down here, and I heard northern people making fun of, like, you know, my father's speech in particular, he's from Georgia, or my grandparents' speech who are from here. And that, oh, it just really burned me up because I can't stand someone making fun of somebody, yeah. You know? And I mean, come on. Like, I heard northerner, you know, Boston, New York, New Jersey, the Minnesota. Entire Midwest, California.
Everybody all
have our regional accents. Everybody has one. And that's one thing I actually enjoy about America. And it's the same as when you hear someone from Britain speak and you can tell if they're from Liverpool versus Southampton versus Northern Britain. Yeah. And it's the same thing that we have here. You can tell by someone's speech pattern where they're usually from in the United States. And I love that. Like, if everyone sounded the same, how boring would that be? You know, it's just a really fun fact about America. However, then we get into this, which is, okay, I don't know if I should try to say it in the southern accent or not. Okay, well, here's one for pig's feet. Be sure and clean tween his toes. You just can't tell where a hog's been. Now, that was my best, you know, like, what a Yankee thinks of Southern people. I mean, we've had...
Don't get me wrong. Neither of us have a strong Southern accent.
We don't, because I mean, we were... Oops. Yeah, go ahead. Say it again.
Yeah, I was going to say, neither of us have a really strong Southern accent anyways.
No.
And, I mean, we can
We're kind of mutts.
Yeah,
we can sound kinda, like we grew up in the North, but we lived down here for longer.
Although I find
So we kind of have this weird twist.
You know, nobody down here thinks I'm ever from here. But if I go visit family in Indiana, they're like, I didn't know you sounded so Southern all of a sudden.
Yeah, I know. It's really weird.
They think I do.
We don't fit in anywhere.
No. But it's like, nobody down here is like, yeah, that's definitely not.
But what I have a problem with, I think, is the spelling choices that makes those kinds of, like, it makes people from the Ozarks and the South sound really dumb, like they have no idea how to spell and or how to, you know, talk. And it's really, that I think is the one thing that I was just like, ooh,
kind of caricature.
This didn't age well. I mean, bear in mind, it's 1969, so different era.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of questionable cookbooks that we've come across from different eras that were just like, ouch, you know? So this was kind of a little bit of an ouch for us, just because we happen to be from, live in this region.
Yeah.
You know, that they're kind of poking fun at. I'd be interested to know if people from Missouri... Also, when you hear that and you see, like, when I'm talking about the spelling, I'm sure you understand what when I'm talking about, like, poor spelling.
If you've ever read Huckleberry Finn or...
Well, now that's the thing. Okay, that's what we were going to think of. Okay, so as most of you probably know, Mark Twain was the very first American author to spell and make his characters talk, like, from the regions he made them from.
Right.
And no other author had ever done that before. So a Southerner sounded Southern reading the vernacular in the book. So
I mean,
we accept it from Mark Twain, but we're like, oh, this cookbook is making fun of it, you know.
Not only that, but my grandfather from Johnson City area was a truck driver for years, and he used to play up the caricature to the extent that, like, I mean, he
would fool people.
Oh, yeah. Like, I mean, he would go around and lay on the accent thick just to make people, like...
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, he played it up. Like, I mean, it's kind of like, you know, you got, like, your comedians, like,
Jeff Foxworthy. They've made their living off of this caricature.
Yeah, Larry the Cable Guy.
Yeah, another living off of it.
I don't know how much of it you can really be mad at because it's something that Southern people have taken and internalized to the point where, like, you know, there's a certain pride that comes with that, too.
That's true. And we've heard, when we went up vacation to Canada, we caught some Canadians playing up their accent when they found out we were not Canadian. Yeah, when they heard our accent, suddenly their accent got a lot thicker with their aboots and their A's and their oots. Yeah. And so I think it's just one of those things where you kind of have fun with people.
Yeah, and we've all got stories of, you know, weird things. When I first moved down here, I didn't know how to say.
Yeah,
we do. I didn't know what they were saying and stuff like that too. So
I guess we've kind of flipped a little bit on it. Like when we first read it, we were like, oh, this is, gosh, how could you sound like that or make us sound so bad?
Yeah.
You know, but then you've got Mark Twain and you've got Jeff Foxworthy. So what do you do?
It's like, you know? It's kind of the caricature that's played up. And
they're
and
making everything. Money off of the caricature.
And I mean, that was sold in Gatlinburg. You know what I mean?
Like, where northern tourists come expecting to see very caricatured
Southern people.
Southern people, yeah. And I mean, we've run into some of these tourists.
Oh, yeah.
And we've had to tell them, please do not pet the bear, and please stop trying to touch a rattlesnake. I mean, I'm serious.
Yeah, the rattle's not for your kid to
play
with.
We've really had to do that, and we're like, oh my God, we're fixing to witness a death.
And
So, yeah, there is a certain expectation, I think, that we have of this area.
Yeah.
And then it's weird to see people coming here that have no clue about it.
Right.
And who expect this.
Yeah.
And expect to pet a bear and live.
Yeah.
You know, and we're just like...
Luckily, the bear usually growls first.
And then and wanders away. Yeah, but still, there's, you know, you never know.
Yeah.
But... So, I guess maybe we shouldn't rate the cookbook based on bad spelling.
I will say that.
And weird vernacular.
The thing about the cookbook that I didn't like, probably more so than like the caricatured
stereotypes,
colloquial English in it, you know what I mean? Was the fact that, like, even with, like, with this food, but with most of the other stuff, there's nothing. There wasn't anything like surprising in there.
No, that's true.
If you look up in a generic cookbook of any sort, this is how they'll tell you to make apple fritters.
That's true.
You know what I mean?
And I noticed that because I was going to pick a dinner. But who wants another recipe for plain meatloaf?
Right.
And it's not
anything special. It's something that you it's like when you look at a recipe for something and it says like this is the basic of what you can do for a thing.
Yeah.
To call it a meatloaf, you have to have these ingredients, and that's basically everybody's meatloaf.
Yeah.
And then you get some recipes that are like, but I like to add this for a little bit of extra flavor, and you do some of this stuff, and it's something different.
And that's what then you pay for.
Yeah, that's an interesting cookbook. This one doesn't do any of that.
No.
Like, it's basic. Like,
fried
get
chicken.
Get a Betty Crocker
fried
cookbook
chicken.
That just gives you the basics of everything, and you'll probably do better.
Now, you would, and this is another thing I'm going to caveat that with, too. Betty Crocker, you can get a basic Betty Crocker with the fried chicken and the collard greens and all that kind of stuff. She's going to tell you, and I say she because I like to pretend she exists. She's going to tell you exactly step by step how to do it.
Yeah.
So if you're a beginner cook, you can make some fried chicken and collard greens.
Right.
This one leaves a ton of stuff out.
Doesn't give you the details and
does
stuff.
Does not give you details. It's written. Some of the recipes are written kind of poorly. This one was written a little bit poor on the poor side. I just kind of guessed and made it up.
But it wasn't anything special either.
No, this isn't beginner friendly at
all. Not beginner friendly, but it's also not...
It's plain.
Yeah, it's also just your introductory recipes.
The only really, like, I guess special part of this cookbook is where they tell you how to cook a groundhog.
Okay, that's different.
Or a possum. Yeah. Or a coon. There was coon and gravy.
Yeah.
In here.
So, I mean, if you're into...
But who's going to make a coon and gravy?
How often are you going
to
do that?
Yeah. I mean, like, to me, this... Okay, unlike the previous two cookbooks that were good, interesting, and I would make it again, and it had a lot... This is plain, kind of boring, and the only... Ooh, we're going to shock you with groundhog.
Yeah.
Who's going to use that?
And I wonder, too, and I didn't see that in there, but how different was cooking groundhog versus, like, cooking any other
the
meat?
The fried chicken in there?
Yeah.
Yeah, like, I mean, you know, not that different.
How different was the recipe? You know what I mean? Like, any other meat that they had? Was there a roast that was basically the same? You know what I mean?
Yeah, it is. It's just, to me, this is more, unlike the other two, which I would keep in my collection and really enjoy. This one is more like a, ha-ha, this is a funny prank you can buy and send to somebody while you're on vacation and like, hey guys, this is what Ozark and Southern people make. I mean, I don't even know what to call it. It's just there. I mean, it's just like... And I mean, it was only a dollar, so I mean, I guess it's you didn't lose
a lot of money. Yeah.
And by the way,
I mean, in the 60s,
if you do want to buy this, there's tons of these things on eBay.
Oh my gosh.
Well, everyone's trying to get rid of it. And unfortunately, there's a Moz Cookin' 2. They made two of these things. So I don't know if y'all are interested. Maybe I'll go ahead and buy Moz Cookin' 2 and we'll review that one too, you know, just to see, just to like, see. Did they improve? But
I mean, did it get any better?
Did it?
I mean, we can always, I could probably find somebody to get us a groundhog.
No. Oh.
I've seen a possum the other day.
Okay. So what are we going to rate this thing?
I don't know.
I kind of have an idea, but...
I'm thinking like a 3.
That's what I was thinking, actually.
Because, I mean, it's not...
Because the desserts look good. They're basic.
Yeah,
if you
it's
just
not,
want basic
it's not,
desserts.
It's not like you can't make food out of it.
Right.
You know what I mean? But at the same time...
Not very much.
There's nothing special in it.
Right.
That would make it worth...
Yeah.
Getting over, like, any kind of other decent recipe book you could get.
I would say it this way. If I give it a 3-2, I would not go out of my way on eBay to buy this thing.
Right.
Individually.
Yeah.
But I've seen it dozens and dozens of times in when I type in vintage cookbook lot. Mm. You know, when you want like a big select, you know, a big box of cookbooks. I've seen this thing thrown in the lot.
Well, yeah.
Like a lot. but so if there's a big, you know, like a thing of cookbooks and you're like, ooh, I want to bid on that, and this happens to be in there, you know.
I mean, it's fun to skim through just to see the weird things in there.
Yeah,
but
I mean.
But at the same time, it's kind of like, no, it's going to be a
caricature.
If you
have a sore throat, you can tie a sock around your neck. That's what it says to do. I'm just saying, there's like, you could read some weird things in here if you want to.
I don't even know what to think of that.
But, you know, I mean, it's just what it is.
It's a caricature. I mean, it's kind of a fun caricature that Southern people have played off of for a long time.
Yeah.
And it's not a
And apparently Ozark people do.
Yeah, it's not an inherently bad caricature.
And interestingly
just
enough,
just understand that it is a caricature.
And
the recipes aren't...
They're not special.
They're not special. I don't even know that I would say they're particularly Southern.
I would have given it a 3 without the weird language in it.
Yeah. Like, either way.
Just because of the recipes.
Yeah, the recipes, like I said, they're not particularly special, I don't think. It does have some weird ones in there, apparently, like groundhog and possum. But, like I said, it's...
It's not fun.
Yeah, I mean, does it tell you how to skin one and everything, too?
Yeah, no. Uh-uh.
I mean, that's the part that's
just assume that us hill people know how to do that.
And, I mean, I would guess that those are probably in there knowing that nobody's going to ever actually use them.
Oh, heck
You know what I mean? Like, it's fully on, fully caricatured for, like...
It's the Jeff Foxworthy of cookbooks.
Yeah, you know what I mean? It's like...
You know.
which is not always a bad thing. Sometimes it's kind of fun.
No, if you want a funny gift,
if it's fun, give it to somebody. Yeah, it's not something I would say like, hey, you got to go out and get this cookbook and try these recipes. You know what I mean?
Like I said, the only way I'd recommend it is if it was thrown into a lot that you were bidding on.
Yeah,
and that, and
if you're
that's
already,
it.
Yeah, it won't bring down the value.
And we've been to Gatlinburg hundreds of times. I've never seen this. So this must have just been a weird 60s, 70s thing that really didn't get repeated.
Yeah, probably.
Which we might, like, when Gatlinburg is...
open again.
It's open, but they're kind of discouraging people from coming because we got a big spread because of, you know, our tourist areas being open. Maybe when, you know, this...
Next summer.
This thing that we won't speak of... is done, maybe we can go to Gatlinburg and just look at some of the little, you know, tourist traps that they have around
we'll
see
a little field trip.
See if there's a modern version of this thing. I would be interested to find out. I'm sure it's more than a dollar, but we'll find out. But so there you go. And funny enough, we did look up to see, like, you know, where the Ozarks was kind of, you know, is it kind of a
Missouri.
What kind of geographical region is it kind of like? And we found out that you guys in Missouri do have a Mark Twain National Forest. So that was kind of cool. We were just talking about Mark Twain. We were like, hey, they actually have a forest named after him. So there you go. We said we wouldn't beat the dead horse, but we kind of did. So
it's good and dead now. She could probably tell us how to eat it.
Yeah, she could boil it. No, but... Okay, on that note, we're getting awful. We gotta go. So we're gonna go. We're gonna eat a few more of these because it's sugar. And stay tuned for next week because we might kick another dead horse.
Uh-oh.
Mamaw's 2 for 3. Will she be 2 for 4?
I mean, a 50 batting average is pretty good still.
You know, it is, but no. I have...
We'll see.
I have less hope for the next one than I did this one.
Yeah.
But we'll... That's a whole nother show.
We'll kick that dead horse later.
Yeah. So, we will see you next week, hopefully, for that. And thank you for watching this, and hopefully you stuck around for this long discussion that we had about accents and weird stuff and groundhogs.
Yeah.
And we'll see you then. So stay tuned. Bye.
If you like this video, make sure to hit the like button and hit the subscribe button for future videos. In the meantime, here are two videos you may enjoy. Thanks for watching.